Proponents of marijuana legalization are thankful the first recreational pot is for sale in Michigan. But is Michigan ready? And after too much focus on union corruption and strike votes, attention is back on the wheels themselves. From an electric Mustang to Tesla's salvo in the truck wars to a new movie taking us on a Ford-fueled thrill ride, the buzz is suddenly back. Today is Sunday, December 1st, 2019, and this is Flashpoint.
Hi, welcome to Flashpoint. I hope you're enjoying what is left of this holiday weekend with such a late Thanksgiving. It is now December, and it feels like Christmas is coming at us at warp speed. We're going to indulge our need for speed this morning. You know, it has been a while since we've just felt a big rush of auto adrenaline. We've been sorting out the far less sexy business of labor contracts and UAW arrests and resignations. But all of a sudden, we've had a lot of Detroit's signature industry to talk about the last few weeks. First, Ford took the wraps off its entry into the all-electric world and its Mustang SUV. Stakes couldn't be higher for that. But just as pre-orders were coming in, Tesla took the wraps off its invasion of the space Ford considers its home turf. What did you make of the Cybertruck? Okay, put aside the disastrous demonstration of the windows. This mashup of a truck and a DeLorean was a polarizing affair, but in no time at all, 200,000 people had put down deposits to get one. We're going to talk about the rush of auto excitement that's back a little bit later on this morning. But up first, today, the few who have been able to land licenses to sell recreational marijuana are now allowed to open the doors on a new era for the state of Michigan. But are we really ready for it? And I mean that in so many ways, from jobs that require drug tests to the race for licenses to the communities who are saying, no, you're not selling that stuff here. Well, is that what you voted for? It's all coming up today on Flashpoint. Today is December 1st, and that means recreational marijuana is now for sale in the state of Michigan. At least it is at the few retailers who've been able to nab licenses and happen to operate in towns that haven't opted out. It has been the Wild West, really, for over a year in Michigan. Is it going to be better now, or does confusion reign, at least for a little while? Let's talk about it this morning with Andrew Brisbow. He's the head of Michigan's Marijuana Regulatory Agency. Anquanet Sarfo is back with us again, the former Detroit news anchor, very familiar face, who's become a leading advocate for medical marijuana in the state. And Dustin Walsh writes about the marijuana industry in Michigan for Crane's Detroit Business. Good to have you all here this morning. Andrew, let me start with you. I don't expect you to tell me, as the representative for the state, no, we're not ready for this. But are we as ready as we should be, or is this going to be chaos for a little while?
Well, I think the law gave us a year to get ready, and we were ready before that. We started taking applications over a month before we had to and issued the first round of licenses here in November. So I think we're as prepared as we can be. The demand is already there. The consumer market exists. So I think it's going to take a while for the regulated industry to catch up with that demand that's already there.
Are we worried at all about the way that a lot of these communities are doing the opt-out? Some of them are really not wanting to be a part of this. Others, it's kind of wait and see, right? We really don't have a handle on what it's going to look like yet.
And the will of the voters, obviously, was to have some degree of municipal control over how many facilities there are and where they're located. Mm-hmm. But I think you're right. A lot of municipalities need a little bit more time to understand what the state-level program looks like. And in many cases, they want to see how it's going to unfold in municipalities that are similarly situated so they can make the best decisions moving forward.
It's interesting because what we have now, Anquanet, are really two different industries. They're supposed to be, in fact, because of the regulations around them, they really are separate. The marijuana side, the medical side and the recreational side. I guess what I find myself wondering is, you've labored so hard for people to understand the medical properties of what's going on here. Does that get lost in the shuffle? And do people now group it all in as one thing?
I don't believe it gets lost in the shuffle. I think that now just the market has expanded. I still feel that you are going to have a lot of people who are going to be recreational users. They're going to make a recreational purchase, but they're going to use that product for a medicinal reason, even if it's to self-medicate themselves or if it's to use it for one of the myriad conditions that's not approved as a qualifying condition here in Michigan. I am concerned about shortages. We've had product shortages all year long, and that this is now going to exacerbate that problem.
An interesting thing has happened with prices as well.
Yes.
That's what happens in shortages.
Absolutely. So the wholesale cost of cannabis right now has increased at least 50%, about 50, but between 35% and 50% in some places. I know that when we were sourcing cannabis maybe 6 months ago, we were paying anywhere from $2,300 to $2,800 a pound, maybe at the most $3,000. Right now, we're receiving word that places are selling it for about $4,500 a pound.
That's
before recreational or adult use sales take effect.
Yeah.
So what's going to happen in the middle of December?
Yeah.
I'm forecasting even more significant shortages.
Yeah. Dustin, you've educated me on so much of this as you've been covering this moving forward. Where would you say, what are your biggest concerns right now as it starts here on December 1st? What do we not really have a handle on yet?
Well, I think she's correct that, you know, the shortages and the pricing is going to be a big issue. People are going to be waiting in lines and then maybe not getting it. And my concern is that people then return to the black market, I think, is the biggest issue that Andrew has to face here and try to get people back to that market. That's been
one of the stunners to learn. A lot of people thought by voting this, making this legal, we're going to chase the black market out of here. That's not what happens.
No, it's not. I mean, what we've seen in other states is the black market continues to grow. As we mentioned earlier, in California, the black market is going to be triple sales of the legal market, which is an astounding number. Again, they're a supply state, and we have to worry whether we become a supply state as more and more product comes online, but that's a long time off. So what happens between now and then is going to be the interesting point to see.
Well, we do have to worry about that part of the black market, Andrew, because we're surrounded by states that have not opted for even medical marijuana in many cases. Don't we become the place where there's a lot of, I guess, for lack of a better word, drug trafficking going across the state lines?
It's certainly something that we have to watch. And we work closely with our law enforcement partners to create a regulatory environment, one that's friendly to business, so we can encourage participation from businesses, create the supply in the regulated market, because I think that pulls consumers in. When we look at price, one of the major factors there is products were sourced from unregulated sources, which keeps costs low. So now that we're building in the fully regulated model, there's testing that's required. So now we can offer some assurance to consumers that the products that they're consuming, they can be sure that it's free of certain contaminants and that it's a safer approach to consuming the products.
It also turns out, though, that it's really expensive to do this the right way, to do it legally, to have the licensing, to do the inspections. So the black market can compete on that front quite easily, can't they?
Well, yeah, there's no control over, say, the pesticides they're using and whether they're safe for human consumption. We've recently seen issues, obviously, with lung injury in individuals that are using products that are contaminated with certain thickeners or cutting agents. So we restrict that in the regulated market through a newly released set of emergency rules to offer some consumer assurance that the products are free of those contaminants. And that's important. But yes, in the short term, that drives costs up as we wait for the regulated supply to grow to meet the consumer demand.
What's your concern about the vaping problem right now? A lot of people, I think, have resorted to that because it doesn't create the smell that the other product does, and that bothers a lot of people who even voted in favor of this. So what are your concerns, though, about trying to figure that out?
I still vape every day. I vape using licensed, tested products. And I tell people all the time, trust the place where you're getting your products from and trust the actual products that you have and that you're using. What's great about the testing mechanism that the state has put in place is that quite often you can just use a QR code on your phone and it takes you instantly to all of the test results for that particular product. So I still have full faith and confidence in tested, licensed, regulated products. But if you're buying a bootleg card off of the street or from the black market, you don't know what you're getting, and it's a very good chance that you're getting something that's made with pesticides and that's cut with something that's illegal and possibly dangerous.
The other thing, Dustin, that's interesting, the communities that have opted out, some of them, the citizens there voted in favor of it.
Mm-hmm.
And then the city council, or however their municipal structure works, have decided to sit it out. There's a really interesting sort of dynamic that's developing around the politics of this.
Right, and I think it's twofold, right? It's either they're doing it because, even though they voted for it, they don't necessarily want to see it. I think there's a lot of that with especially things that used to be illicit, right? It may be legal now, but I still don't want to see it.
Mm-hmm.
And the other aspect too is who's writing those local, you know, municipal laws. It's always we always compare it to prohibition, right, with alcohol. Well, who do you think wrote the laws when we were re-regulating alcohol? People that drank. I think in this case, not a lot of those people are marijuana users. So it's tough to kind of navigate that in the will of the people. And it's really easy to put out a press statement that says, no, we're not interested, than it is to actually draft compassionate, common sense rules to allow that in your community.
Two other components I'll let anybody weigh in on it that wants to. Law enforcement trying to be ready for how they're supposed to deal with this new world, but also, as I mentioned earlier, businesses, a lot of them drug test, and a lot of them, is it going to be ethical for a business to say you can't test positive for marijuana if it's legal in the state for people to smoke marijuana?
I'll jump in.
Sure.
It is one of my goals is to make sure that more and more companies decide to no longer test for cannabis use. I was a person who was on 9 pharmaceuticals, anything from Adderall to muscle relaxants. I'm pretty sure that I'm a much safer person on the streets, basically taking my cannabis at night and then getting up in the morning and going about my day, as safe as I was compared to all of the other medications or drugs that I was on. When you look at alcohol use, if people are not tested for alcohol use, I feel they shouldn't be tested for cannabis use. It's one thing, you should never come to your job under the influence of anything. And there are ways that you can make sure people are not under the exact influence of a drug in that moment. But to blanket to a zero tolerance policy on all drug on testing for cannabis, I'm hopeful that more Michigan companies will follow suit, like Las Vegas and other places in New York, where they've decided to no longer test for cannabis use.
I think this problem will eventually sort itself out because the issue, the main issue that companies don't care either way. They just want a safe workplace.
Yeah.
They don't want to deal with it. So the issue that they're having is, I can test you if you get into an accident in a high low or whatever. I can test you to see if you're drunk. I can't test you to see if you are immediately under the influence of marijuana.
Yeah.
As that technology changes, as the drug testing becomes more clear, more concise, that problem will take care of itself. They'll eliminate drug testing because they want as many people to work at their company as they can. They're not going to care anymore. As soon as the science catches up, that'll answer the questions for them.
Great conversation as we step into a new era. As we said, we can change things legally, culturally, might take a little bit longer. Thank you all very much for being here. Terrific to have you.
Thank you.
We come back, we'll talk about all the buzz in the auto world. This is Flashpoint on Local 4.
I've got a certain gift this time of year to make my friends and family cheer.
Cool, man.
What could it be?
Something for me.
Yes, sirree. Holiday instant.
From the lottery.
We're ready.
Not done yet. Instant games are fun to give.
They're fun to get.
They're easy to buy.
Very true.
That's why they're my go-to gift.
This year, give the go-to gift. Holiday instants from the Michigan Lottery.
You probably associate your sinus pain with the weather or the changing seasons, but you don't have to suffer any longer. Are you constantly getting treated for sinus infections? If so, it's time to call the Detroit Sinus Center. Using a state-of-the-art office procedure called balloon sinus dilation, Dr. Pinnock has improved the lives of thousands of patients, and he can help you too. Call now to schedule an appointment for a fast, pain-free treatment. It's time to breathe free. Call today or visit us online at DetroitSinusCenter.com.
Are you looking to save money on your mortgage or lower your payment? Well, right now is definitely the time to call Hall Financial with rates at their lows of the year. We're seeing a record number of refinances at Hall Financial right now. Call us today for a 5-minute mortgage review. And with over 800 5-star reviews, why would you look anywhere else? Call 248-308-5000 or chat with us online at davidhallmortgage.com. Lower payments, better options, more personal attention.
What a wonderful day for America's Thanksgiving Parade, presented by Art Van.
It couldn't get better than this.
Look at all those floats.
Look at all those smiles.
These heroes do wear capes.
Captain Underpants.
Definitely one of our favorites.
The best parade in the country.
What a great way to kick off the holiday season.
Wishing you the happiest of holidays from Local 4 and Click on Detroit.
Welcome back. There is so much sudden buzz right now in the auto world. I am truly sorry that we have to wait another 7 months for the North American International Auto Show. If we were headed to Kobo next month, we'd be doing it on the wings of stories about the electric Mustang SUV and the Cybertruck from Tesla. Why, even your local movie theater is car-driven at the moment with so much attention on Ford versus Ferrari. Let's talk about it with John McElroy from Autoline Detroit. Back with us again. Phoebe Wall Howard, the auto writer for the Detroit Free Press, is with us this morning. Sam Abolsamid is the principal analyst with Navigant, and Henry Payne, the auto writer for the Detroit News. Gang, thanks for being here. I want to start by throwing this meat on the table. John, the biggest development of the last 2 weeks, Ford's entry into electric cars with the Mustang SUV. or the Cybertruck, which, depending on your point of view, was either a disastrous unveiling or the coolest thing in a long time?
Look, both huge, huge introductions. Very important for both. No question about it, though, Tesla got way more publicity out of it, partly because of those windows, supposedly bulletproof, that they were able to shatter. Yeah. It was a good one for Ford, too, though. It got a lot of publicity as well.
Yeah.
Elon, I think they're now up to 250,000 deposits on their truck. My guess is Ford is not going to announce what their number is, because it's going to be so much smaller.
Phoebe, what did you think was the bigger of the two?
Absolutely, Tesla took the headline, and obviously Wall Street is, it's reflecting that. Mm-hmm. So Tesla shares are at $330, and Ford shares are at $9.09. So now is the time to invest if you believe in this product, because it's a good deal. The valuation, Tesla's $60 billion, Ford is at $36 billion. Mm-hmm. So the markets are watching this. But it's Tesla's really stealing the headlines. And of course, there was a challenge from a top executive at Ford.
Sam, you got a counter narrative for me?
Yeah, I think, in terms of the importance to the companies, I think the Mustang Mach-E was more important to Ford because it really shows, for the first time, what's really been going on behind the scenes for the last 2.5 years since Jim Hackett took the top job at Ford, that, there's really some activity going on over there. Certainly, the Cybertruck has the potential to be something really important as a product for Tesla. But I think Ford's move heavily into electrification is really being shown now.
So. And Henry, your thoughts. As a guy who drives a Tesla, I will point out famously, you've written a lot about your experience with the Tesla.
Yeah, I mean, it's such an exciting time for the industry, I think, to have this startup out there outside of Detroit in a different culture in Silicon Valley, reimagining the automobile. I mean, it makes everybody rethink every segment. What's fascinating to me about both these reveals is they bookended the Los Angeles Auto Show. You had Ford come out at the start of the show and go right at the Tesla Model 3, Model Y franchise, which is the core of Tesla's business. Tesla ends the show by saying, okay, we'll one-up you. We're going right at the Ford F-150, which is your franchise. So it'll be great to see how these play out. I think ultimately the Cybertruck's the bigger market because this is the biggest segment in the United States, the truck segment. If Tesla can conquer that, that's a
lookout. It was fascinating watching the rollout in real time. It was happening during the 11 o'clock news, and we're trying to watch on phones and following the Twitter feed, and there was so much of it that looked like a disaster. You mentioned the windows. There were a lot of people that thought the whole thing was like a put-on. And then they roll out this thing that, as I said, looks like a mashup between a truck and a DeLorean. I'm not sure everybody thought that everything was on the up and up, but then it turns out it is. And it's a polarizing thing, but I guess back to the only bad publicity is no publicity, huh?
Yeah, that's exactly right. But two things I'd like to point out. The Tesla truck, I believe, a lot of the styling is driven by trying to avoid tooling cost. It looks like you don't have to stamp these panels out at all. Mm. And if you do, you use far fewer die sets. That can save tens of millions of dollars. Also, it's stainless steel. You don't have to paint it. That saves another fortune. This is one of the ways I think that Elon was able to say the base truck being electric is only $39,000. Okay, that's the story on Tesla. On Ford, what I find amazing is Jim Hackett comes into the company. They find they're going to be doing, he finds they're working on a compliance EV. Essentially, they were going to take a Ford Escape, stuff it full of batteries, try to get the ZEV credits that they need from the government, call it a day. And Hackett was like, no, let's get a car out that people really want to buy and that we can make a profit on. So they tore up the program they were working on. They were a year into it, started all over again, and they're still going to hit their original timing date. So that tells me something very different is going on inside the Ford Motor Company.
Yeah, really interesting. I'm very excited about that vehicle. But it is interesting, Phoebe, the way that Tesla has changed, the way the other automaker, by bringing a set of eyes that wasn't locked into the old way of doing things and kind of turning it over to a bunch of Silicon Valley engineers, it kind of taught the old dog some new tricks.
Well, actually, it's also fair to point out that so many Detroit 3 engineers are flying back every single week, back and forth, back and forth. Uh-huh. So they've got the energy here. They're going back and forth. Henry talked about it earlier. But this is a very real development, and the energy is here in Detroit. It's not just in Silicon Valley.
Yep.
But the other thing to point out, and it's curious, the Ford is a $500 deposit, and the Tesla is a $100
deposit. Yes.
So, you know, in terms of traction and response, that's a very different price point for some people.
That is interesting. Sam, what did you make of the whole Tesla pulling the F-150 in the video? Is that much ado about nothing?
It is. You know, I mean, those manufacturers do those kinds of stunts all the time. You know, we saw the Ford F-150 electric prototype pulling a million-pound train about a month or so ago. You know, it doesn't really mean much of anything, and especially in this case, because we don't know what the real conditions are of that test were. We don't, you know, first of all, it was a rear-wheel drive Ford versus a four-wheel drive Tesla.
Right.
We don't know how much weight they had loaded in the back of that Tesla to give it extra traction. So I wouldn't put too much stock in anything related to that particular demo.
It was fun.
Oh, yeah. You know, no, it got the kind of attention, and that's the thing that Elon is good at. He's a great showman, you know, not a great speaker, but a great showman, great at riling up his fan base.
And Ford took the bait.
Oh, yeah.
Started complaining about
it. Well, at least one Ford executive did.
Yeah, exactly.
But I think he probably got a quick call from PR saying, quiet, don't say anything else.
Yes. Henry, at the base problem, though, of all this, the naysayers will say, can't you get it through your head? People don't want to buy electric cars.
Right.
Stop it.
Right.
That's going to be the hardest thing for both these companies to sell. I drive a Tesla Model 3 in part because I wanted to learn what it's like to live with an EV. I talked to a number of truckers this week about the Tesla Cybertruck, and I was surprised how many like it. They found it refreshing to see this different design in a cab box segment that we've seen for decades, but talk to them a little bit deeper, and you get concerns about towing capability. Mm-hmm. Towing is a huge drain on batteries.
Yep.
Climate, guys use these vehicles as their offices. They sit there and just idle for long periods of time. So a lot of questions that batteries need to answer in this segment.
Well, two other things that come up. When you go to Somerset and Troy, and you go to where the Teslas are on display, people will talk, Michigan people and visitors from the surrounding states will say they go to see the Tesla operations in California the way people go to Disneyland. They're actually taking their families to see that. And the other issue you have is how Tesla has changed the entire dialogue. Ford, Fiat Chrysler, General Motors, they will say we owe a gratitude to Elon Musk, absolutely, in terms of opening how people think, what's possible, what should we be talking about?
And Ford actually pretty much stole the Tesla playbook for the Mach-E. Everything that Tesla has done successfully, they applied that to when they switched the program for the Mach-E.
Yep. You can see that just the screen structure.
Yeah, I mean the whole architecture of the vehicle.
We will get into the other crazier side of what's been going on in the auto industry. We're going to take a quick break. We come back, we'll talk about this lawsuit filed by General Motors against Chrysler. This is Flashpoint I'm looking for.
Forgotten Harvest is a lifesaver for a mother like myself with children and having so many snacks and lunches to make.
The food from Forgotten Harvest makes me feel better in school.
Because these children around this community really look for Forgotten Harvest. And I thank Forgotten Harvest for helping me and my family out.
Forgotten Harvest needs your support to help families in need.
We need your help today.
Hey, I'm Matthew Stafford. As a professional athlete, I'm fortunate to have a team of doctors who care for me. And it's equally important that you have your team too. First and foremost, a primary care physician. It's like having a quarterback for your health, for preventative care or the right team of specialists when you need them. My family knows from personal experience, St. Joe's is the place to turn. Assemble your team. Connect with a St. Joe's doctor today.
As I live my life, I am increasingly surprised by my strength, my determination, by the power of my beliefs. I find reward in the honesty of my endeavors, proud of what I have achieved, and convinced there is much more I can do.
It's one of the iconic unsolved crimes in American history. What happened to Jimmy Hoffa? Now, hear from the people who knew him.
Jimmy was innocent.
A story about power and control.
Wouldn't back down from anybody.
Taking you from the Teamsters to the Senate.
Do you have any evidence?
To mobsters.
Gangsters, I am not controlled by them.
History has its heroes and villains. Sometimes one man is both. Hoffa. Wednesday at 10 on Local 4. Download the podcast Shattered Hoffa December 3rd.
Welcome back. Before we go this morning, we've talked a lot about corruption problems at the UAW, but a really interesting lawsuit filed 2 weeks ago by General Motors alleging corrupt bargaining practices that ended up infecting the rest of the industry against FCA and the late Sergio Marchionne. Phoebe, what's going on?
Well, the idea that you would use a mafia, it's a law created to fight the mafia.
Right.
And so now General Motors is saying this applies to Fiat Chrysler. And by the way, Ford is absolutely staying out of this, which is also very interesting that they're saying it corrupted. But the issue, here's the challenge for General Motors. Not was there corruption, but can they prove the company itself was damaged? They're saying we were hit on how much we paid, but they have to show much more because, frankly, the defense for Fiat Chrysler is how good were your products? What kind of cars did you launch? Did you have a good marketing campaign? How many recalls did you have? So all the legal experts say doing this under RICO, if you're proving a criminal case, like the Department of Justice does, you just prove criminal activity. In the private sector, you have to prove a pain point.
But this unique structure of the model contract and then everybody else having to model those on what the others are doing, I guess there's an interesting argument. John, any idea what's going on here?
I have no idea what's going on. I want to know what's going on because what is GM really after here? To recoup some damages? You know, up until this point, it's been bragging about how well it's been doing financially and how smart they've been putting things together, and they have. So what are they trying to do here? I mean, this could absolutely destroy FCA if they were to win a RICO case against them. So I gotta believe there's something more going on.
Sam, quickly.
I have no idea.
It's
a real mess. Yeah.
Henry? But you know, I was in L.A. last 2 weeks, and this news broke in L.A. This is a problem that only the big three have to deal with, the union issue.
And that's going to do it for us. Thanks so much for being here, gang. We really appreciate it. Thank you as well. Meet the Press coming up next. Hope you have a great week. We'll see you next time on Flashpoint. I don't know how you managed to...